Welcome to the Fossum 2017 Distributions Dev Room. We have Thorsten Kukuk here talking to us about transactional updates with ButterFS.
Okay, thank you. So, about 2 years ago, there was an article in a German newspaper. I think that most of you don't understand German. It's a rough translation. The scoreboard did not work, and that was the reason why a basketball team was being relegated to a lower division due to a Windows update. So what did happen was, short before the match would start, they had problems with their Windows PC, who was driving the scoreboard and taking the time. So they decided to reboot the machine, and when the machine should come up, all the Windows updates were applied, and the game started about 20 minutes late. They won the game, but on the green table later, it was decided they lose it. They got malus bounce, and so they were relegated to a lower division. And when I read this, it was clear for me, I never want to see there that a Linux system or update was the fault, that a team is relegated or something else, somebody else has problems because of that. So why did I show that? What were the problems I'm facing? Why did I look at updates at all? Normally, if you have enterprise customers, they're always telling you most important thing is the machine has to be up. Uptime of 99.999999% are still not good enough. The best is never reboot the machine. But there are also other customers who are saying, if I do an update and my application is interrupted during the update, it's much more worse to me than if I now I have to do a scheduled reboot at a fixed point of time. Only imagine you have a cluster of web servers doing some web forms running and your customer wants to press the send by button and then the web server is restarted. That's bad for them. So Android has something similar. If you update on Android an application, APK package, and you are currently using it, then it's missing. So it's gone on it. So that's something customers don't want, that their customers have problems. So the question was coming up, if you couldn't apply the updates in a way that the service are not interrupted, and they know that at some point in time they have to reboot the machine to activate the changes. And the update should be either fully applied or no change at all. So if your update fails for some reason, the post-install script doesn't work, whatever, there shouldn't be an undefined state of the system, like one RPM is installed twice in two different versions, whatever. It should always be a defined clear state. So when I got these requirements, I also got from our OpenSUSE folk the requirements, can we not use that for OpenSUSE 2, Tumbleweed? What are the problems with rolling distributions? If you listen to Richard this morning, his presentation, OpenSUSE spends a lot of time in testing with OpenQA and so on and make sure that updates itself are fine and working. If you follow the OpenSUSE factory list, you will see if you log out, log in as root on the console, apply the patches, log out, log in again as user, everything is fine. But most of the time today, people click on a button, the update is applied, and now imagine you are using your desktop and a new major version is released at the same time and it's updated. Most likely your running desktop will not survive the update and crash, and you have a system in an undefined state. If you have luck, you could start the update a second time and it's finished and everything works. If you have bad luck, then you need to reinstall or do a rollback of it, either way. So we need a way to apply intrusive updates without any impact for the user who is currently using the system. So that's why we came up with transactional updates. The definition is more or less the same as Debian is using for, now Ubuntu is using for their transaction update wording. So transaction update is something which should be atomic. So either it's fully applied or it's not applied at all. And the update should not influence your running system. So if I install a new Apache or database, then the currently running database should continue. Only think about the upgrade from Postgres 7 to 8. If during this update the database is converted, there's a long time where you cannot access your database. And that's all. In some scenarios, you don't want at all. And of course, if something goes wrong, if you got a new kernel and the new kernel does not work with your old hardware, whatever, you want to have an easy way to roll back to the old state and not need a rescue disk or whatever. So, I know there are already solutions. Some distributions work with different partitions, so where you update one partition and then jump to the next one with the next boot. Other use special package formats. We have OS3, but all the solutions have one major drawback. You need a redesign of your system or your tools, especially if you have a new package format. But if I look at our OpenSUSE infrastructure or SUSE infrastructure for the enterprise customers or at our customers, they all know how RPMs are working. There's their infrastructure to build RPMs, to verify RPMs. So I was looking for something that we can stay with what we have already. And in the end, it's quite easy if you have a current OpenSUSE or slash version. All you need is ButterFS with snapshots and rollback enabled by default. You need Snapper to manage the snapshots. You need subparts to update the system. And of course, ButterFS utilities to make some modifications to the file system. If you don't want to use RPM and these tools, of course, you can also use other package managers by adjusting the script. In the end, it's really generic and it works with everything which can do snapshots and rollback. But in this case, I try to use what our distributions provide. Who of you know how snapshots and rollback are working? Either with BitterFS or something similar. Okay, not much. Okay, so in the end, you have always one root file system. The file system only contains, or should only contain your applications. It should not contain data. If it contains data and you make a rollback later because you broke something, the changes of the data goes lost. Coming back to a web shop, if you have a customer entering a big order, you are doing a rollback, then the order is gone from your database. That's why you should always separate applications and data if you use snapshots and rollback. That's independent if you use ButterFS, LVM, OS3 or whatever. It's a general rule there. Every time you make a modification to your root file system, you create at first a new snapshot. Over the time, you have one root, you create a lot of snapshots. Of course, there are tools to clean up old snapshots you don't need anymore. And so now you want to update your system. At first, we create a new snapshot. And then we run zipper up in the current root, which means the difference between this and this snapshot is only what zipper up did modify. So it's not a one-to-one copy, so you don't waste a lot of disk space for all these copies. But the difference is only really always what was modified between the snapshots. That's a nice effect. If you want to know what your update did change on this, you can run a diff between two snapshots. And a snapper diff will list you exactly the differences between these two snapshots. And so you can see what was really changed during the update. But now, why always only creating, updating the current root and having all these snapshots there? I hopefully never need, only for rollback in worst case. Why not doing it the other way? I have a snapshot, I create a new snapshot, and so on until I have my current root. Now I create a new snapshot of my current root file system. It's a read-only clone by default with butterfs. I need to change it read-write. Quite simple with butterfs tools. I run superapp in this change root environment. You can call superapp with a def big R argument and give it the pass to the snapshot. So only the data inside of the snapshot will be updated. I change it back read-only. And now I'm doing a rollback as I would normally do in recovery case. Which means I still have my current system. I still have a snapshot with all the changes. With the next reboot, this is my new root file system. If something is not working, I can jump back to my old root file system. If everything is working over the time, I can delete the old snapshots because I don't need them anymore. So in the end, it's the same with doing as doing snapshots and rollback, only that I change the order. I'm not modifying the current system, but the new snapshot. How to do that transaction updates in the script? It's quite simple. With snapper, I create a new snapshot, save the ID. I set it with butterfs to read-only to false that I can write in it. Call zipper, tell him where he can find the snapshot to update. Make a snapper rollback so that the new snapshot will be active and taken. And at a good time where it fits, I reboot. And I'm done. After the reboot, I'm having my patches applied and have still the old snapshot. So this all sounds great, but every time you have something which is helpful, you also have drawbacks of it. There are some requisites you need to look at, take care of. These requisites are not only for super butterfs. If you look at the documentation for S3, for example, or for distributions where using several partitions, they all have the same requirements that it works more or less defined, good documented. Something I learned with this is the best is really to having a read-only root file system, because then it's pretty clear what is snapshot. You cannot make modifications after the snapshot. Because if you have a read-write file system and create a snapshot and you do modifications on your old root file system, with the next reboot into the new snapshot, all changes are of course gone. So you need to reapply them again. Which is the reason why you shouldn't either use a read-only file system or do the reboot pretty fast after you made the update. So the most important one is strictly separate data from applications in your file system or subvolumes. /SRV is in this regard a real nightmare because you have PHP, Tomcat, user data, databases, everything, sometimes even in the same directory. And either you do a rollback of everything or nothing, which means if your PHP update or Tomcat update is broken and you do a rollback, your database, your data is also rollbacked. That's a real nightmare for people having to create snapshots and rollback. Also, you need to take care what RPMs are doing in their pre-post-install sections. If you have a new package format special designed for transaction updates or snapshots, they solve it quite simple. They don't allow you to have pre-post-install sections where you can modify something. If you continue to use your old RPMs, over the time you should audit the pre-post-install sections and make sure that they don't do stupid things in this regard. So don't modify data. Most of the time you don't have access to them anyways. So you should not convert the data during the update, but convert your database at the first reboot or if the application, the new one, is started or something similar. when you are sure this application is now the new one running and be used, and not another older version is still accessing the database. And then you should not create, of course, directories, files, whatever, outside of your root file system or the default snapshot subvolume. Don't fiddle around with running processes. If you try to restart yourself and you are updating a snapshot, then afterwards the old process will be started again and not the new one, because it's still the one in the default search path. And you should be able to scope with different data formats. This is, for, especially for desktop, a big problem. If you are in a network and your home directory is shared via NFS, and on one machine you have an old version of your most likely desktop, on a newer machine you have a new version, and you switch between the two machines with the same NFS home directory, I'm pretty sure you saw more than once that after you logged in on the new machine and go back to the old one, your desktop looks pretty broken, because your desktop did convert all data at the first login, and then the old version cannot be scoped with it anymore. So, yes, and then there are some directories for snapshots you should normally exclude, like waspool, because you don't want to lose your email, and log. It's always good to have the log file, the old one. So, is this already in use? Yes. We use it already in our in some of our products. So SUSE Container as a Service platform is a new product we announced last year and currently is in development. It's the only way to do updates on this product, because it is using a read-only root file system, so you cannot use traditional zipper up. It's read-only, it will not work. It will be a rolling release, so we will see big intrusive updates, and we want to avoid that the system will break during the update. So with transactional updates, we found a solution to update the system in a safe way, being able to go forward and backward. Then we have OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. If you looked, I think 2 days ago, how many RPMs we updated in one night, I think it was 367 for the default installation only. I don't know what else was updated. It has things like systemd update, Xamba update, KDE5 updates it contain. Doing it in a running system, this update, even if you tested everything, it's a little bit tricky and critical. With the transaction updates, you can update the snapshot. Your current system will continue to run, and then afterwards, after reboot, everything is active. If it's not working, you can go back to the old. The script for it itself is now part of Tumbleweed since some weeks, but on some test systems, it's all running since over 3 months without any problems. So all Tumbleweed updates during the last 3 months were updated with transactional updates on that machines. They booted automatically when they foot. So if there was an update and the reboot window they reached, then they rebooted themselves and there was no problem, no error message, nothing, it worked. So the code for it, the script is in GitHub. And are there now questions about this?
I have
yes?
questions.
Yes.
The first question, at the beginning of the talk, you said that one of the advantages of transactional updates in the file system was that it would work with the existing package manager and existing software.
Yes.
A bit later, you said that, that using the system puts constraints on the package manager, which should not do certain things. How do you conserve it?
So, if you look at OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, for example, the default packages are fine, they are working. If you look at special packages, maybe you need to adjust them. But you can start already today. You don't need to convert 6,000 packages overnight to be able to start. But you can start with the default set, I don't know how many these are currently for Tumbleweed, which, how many are installed in the default, but the default installation is fine, and over the time more and more packages will be adjusted. But if a package makes trouble, it does not break your system. So if there is a RPM who is doing bad things in their pre-post install, the script will say, okay, something is not correct, update did not work, delete the snapshot, not reboot, and your system is still working. And then you can go and fix this package.
Okay, so you mean this you can make the change in an incremental way instead
yes.
of changing your whole package manager once all the same at a time, right?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Here's my second question.
Yes.
How does ButterFS and the specific features of ButterFS interact with the POSIX API for the file system? I guess that the transactional primitives are not POSIX. So how does that work? Do you need special calls? Do you need?
No, you need nothing of that. So ButterFS is a copy-on-write file system,
yes.
which means you have one file, you make a modification to the file, so ButterFS is creating for you a second file and the old one is still there. If there is a reference from an old snapshot, the old file will not be deleted, but is visible in the old snapshot. If you have no reference anymore, then this old file is deleted. So that is completely behind the file system, invisible to POSIX and the applications. So if you want to do snapshots, you need special kernel EOCTL to call them. Of course, they are not POSIX conform because POSIX doesn't know it. But else, all file system operations are POSIX conform.
Yes, so it's all normal file system operations except
yes.
for what, IOCTL or something else? Or something
there like is an IOCTL with which you could tell ButterFS that this subvolume should now be cloned.
Okay.
Or that it should be now read-only, read-write, or that this subvolume should now be the new root file system with the next reboot. So these are the things you could set with this EOCTL. Richard, you are next.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to the question about changing packages to conform with this. Coincidentally, the requirements that are listed there pretty much identically match all of the practice guidelines which OpenSUSE has had for a really long time. So in our case, if it's not working with this, it's because we've broken our own guidelines. So where they were guidelines, they now don't have to be requirements.
And these requirements are not only valid for transactional updates. If you really want to take advantage of snapshots and rollback, you should follow them too. So more questions. We have, I think, 2 minutes more. If not, yes?
Do you prevent the scripts from actually messing with running processes by using namespaces or something like that? If an update script would attempt to restart the process, would it fail?
So it depends. So systemd, for example, always tries to connect and restart their scripts and fails because the sockets systemd is using for communication are not available in this environment. Else, all our, at least for OpenSUSE, the RPMs, if the RPM is using the macro to restart the daemon, the macro detects that it is in a situation where it should not restart the daemon and does not even try to restart the daemon. So it really depends on how this restart is implemented in the post-install, if it succeeds or not. There are some scripts who are looking in the with PS in the process list and kills everything which has the same name as itself and start itself new. This is something you cannot prevent if it is doing it from the transactional update script. If it is using our standard OpenSUSE macros for restarting a daemon, it works. It will not influence the running processes because the macro itself has already signed, I don't know how many years support for it. Does it answer your question? Okay, more questions. I think we have half a minute. Yes?
Following on from that, I don't know very much about RPM, is there any benefit to using containers since it's the same root file system? Would that provide more isolation if you dropped into another namespace and then came out after the update?
So I cannot say much about containers, but you have an operating system running the containers, and for this you need some kind of this. So the container as a platform, service platform, is exactly such an operating system running containers, and you need to update the core system. And for this, we introduced this.
I'm meaning a partial container, the namespace, but without going for the whole separation, so using the same file system. But
as I said, I cannot say much about containers. It's not my world. Sorry. Yes, Lenz?
How well does this play together with live patches?
That is always an interesting question. Can I combine it with live patching? Mm-hmm. You can only combine it with live patching if you can do live patching to all running processes and libraries. So live patching is to avoid reboot. Transactional updates requires a reboot. So you it's conflicting. It doesn't fit together. It doesn't make much sense. So I think time is over since a minute already. So then I want to thank you for coming and listening.